This video is sponsored by Great Courses Plus. If you've been watching any of my videos on quantum mechanics, then you know that the smallest particles in nature behave in some very strange ways. These particles include things like photons, electrons, atoms, and even some molecules. You know that observation is synonymous with measurement. The double slit experiment shows that they behave like waves of probability when not measured. And quite strangely, when measured, these probability waves collapse so that they become distinct particles. We also see from experiments like the delayed choice quantum eraser that two particles can become entangled, meaning that they appear to be somehow intimately connected through the sharing of one probability wave, even if the particles are separated apart in space-time. And this behavior seems really strange to us because this is not something that we observe in our macro world. But why is that? Why don't we see this kind of strange and mysterious behavior in our everyday lives? Why doesn't this tennis ball behave like a photon, or an electron, or an atom? At what point does the quantum behavior stop and classical behavior of everyday objects like this begin? And why is there a cutoff? The explanation is coming up right now. Scientists have shown quantum behavior in particles as large as molecules containing hundreds of atoms. How large a particle can you get and still show quantum behavior? What if I take this tennis ball and throw it at a double slit with a screen behind it that records the position of the ball when it hits the screen? What if I take thousands of these tennis balls and throw it at a double slit? Will I see the same kind of behavior that electrons or atoms have? No, of course not. I'll just see two patterns on the back wall. Why doesn't this thing behave like electrons or atoms? It's made up of atoms and electrons around it, 6 trillion trillion atoms. Why doesn't the whole behave like the individual particles it's made up of? To answer this, we have to understand some of the basics of quantum mechanics. Let's look at how the double slit experiment works with light first. The results are the same with electrons or atoms. Richard Feynman called this the central mystery of quantum mechanics. When we shine a monochromatic light, that is light of only one wavelength, through two slits, as light hits the screen, we see an interference pattern on the other side, because as the waves spread out, the crest of one wave hits the crest of another, it becomes stronger. Where a crest hits a trough, it will cancel. This should be no big mystery. This is not quantum mechanics. This is just a property of waves. It'll happen with water waves too. Now, what if we lower the intensity of the light and keep lowering it until our light source emits only one photon at a time? Surely this should not create a wave pattern. When we shoot one photon at a time, it forms a dot on the screen. But if you fire enough of them, thousands or millions of photons, what you find is that collectively the photons form the same interference pattern. So somehow the photon either interacts with itself or somehow is able to communicate its part in the interference pattern when fired one at a time. So since we want to find out what's going on at the slits, what if we put a detector there to determine whether the photon goes through slit one or slit two? This is the most startling result of quantum mechanics, because when you try to find out which path the photon took, the interference pattern disappears. The photon appears to now behave like a particle instead of a wave. So what's going on? Let's talk in the language of the Copenhagen interpretation, which is the most accepted interpretation of quantum mechanics. This was conceived by Niels Bohr and Werner Heisenberg at the University of Copenhagen around 1927. This interpretation basically says that these so-called particles are not particles at all, but really like clouds. They are in multiple states at the same time. They're like waves of probabilities. The waves become distinct like particles only when they are measured. At the point at which the probability wave becomes a distinct particle is called a collapse of the probability wave. What scientists have found is that at any point when the which path information, any particle is measured, its probability wave collapses. For the particles to remain probability waves, their path information must remain in absolute secrecy. If at any point any kind of measurement is made, whether it is seen by anyone or not, the particles become distinct and do not display wave-like behavior. This same behavior has been found in subsequent years with electrons, atoms, and even molecules composed of as many as 800 atoms. The same interference pattern forms and the same collapse occurs if their which path information is measured. A measurement always collapses the wave. So what is a measurement? A measurement is a formation of any physical record of which path the particle takes. It's not about conscious observers. It's about a record made in the universe, even if no one is looking. It is such that a forensic exam, if we had even the most sensitive quantum tools, could establish which path the particle took. You never have to look at the information. You can even destroy the information before you look at it, like burn it, or destroy the hard drive that it's on. The wave will still collapse because the universe already recorded it. Why is it recorded even if you destroyed it? Because theoretically, you could go back in time and see the path. The universe will say, hey, I already know the path. Now it's a particle. You can't have your wave back. The path has to be taken in absolute secrecy. The particle has to be informationally isolated. The interference can only occur if it is impossible, even in principle, to find out which path the particle took. Now, as I said, this happens with photons, electrons, atoms, and even large molecules. Now, what if we do this with really large particles, like grains of sand, which, by the way, are typically composed of quintillions of atoms, or tennis balls? Will we see the same pattern? Of course not. We'll just see two lines on the other side of the double slit. Why don't we see this behavior with tennis balls? The reason is that large objects are nearly impossible to isolate informationally from the outside world. What do I mean by this? Let's look and see what it would take to isolate a tennis ball. Remember, to do this, we have to make sure that there is no record made anywhere in the universe of which path the tennis ball follows. First, we have to remove all the air and photons in the experiment. Why? If a photon or air molecule bounces off the tennis ball, then it has potentially recorded the path of the tennis ball. For example, if the photon reflects off the ball, then that could be a measurement because the path of the photon would be changed, and the bounced path of the photon has recorded the path information of the ball. Potentially, someone or the universe could examine the paths of all the photons in the room, find out how they were affected by the path of the tennis ball, and find out from that information the path that the tennis ball took. And the same thing applies for atoms. We'll also need to cool this tennis ball to near absolute zero, because a ball that has any temperature will emit photons due to something called black body radiation. This is a property of all bodies with a temperature above absolute zero, which is, by the way, negative 273 degrees Celsius. The emitted photons will have recorded the information about the tennis ball such that someone examining the photons in the room could determine the path of this tennis ball. We even have to worry about the small amount of gravitation that the tennis ball will have. Why? Because this gravitation of the tennis ball will affect nearby atoms. This, in principle, can allow someone to determine the path that this tennis ball took. The movements of nearby atoms can also form a record of the path of that tennis ball. We have to completely isolate the tennis ball because any information that is leaked to the universe about its path will create a record, even if this information is recorded in one atom. It is still information which has been captured in the universe, and the tennis ball will not be superposition. Will not be a cloud. It'll be a distinct entity. Macroscopic objects like this are very difficult, if not impossible, to isolate informationally. So in our everyday experience, we will not see quantum superposition or wave-like behavior of macro objects. But one principle of quantum mechanics is that it applies to all objects regardless of size. Could the tennis ball behave like an atom if we could isolate it informationally? This may be true, but there's a measurement problem. We can look at this mathematically. The wave of an object is described by the de Broglie wave function. Lambda equals Planck's constant over mass times velocity. Since the Planck constant is so tiny and the mass m so huge, the wavelength will be extremely small. So the interference pattern, for all intents and purposes, will approximate no interference. The quantum mechanical behavior of the tennis balls converges to classical behavior. Its interference is so small that it probably cannot even be measured. So the tennis balls and other large objects like our bodies are going to be about as real and here as you're going to get. This is the reason you and I and the cat in Schrödinger's experiment are not in superposition. The cat is not dead and alive at the same time. That's a myth. And there's no possibility of interference patterns being formed in our normal everyday interactions. And for the same reasons, macroscopic objects like this cannot be entangled in the way photons can be entangled, for example. So what we see macroscopically is a very different world than what we see microscopically. And this is why it's a mistake to extrapolate our observations and equations in quantum mechanics to our everyday experiences. They behave in completely different ways. They are two different worlds. Quantum mechanics is what happens when no one is looking. This is what makes it so mysterious. It's as if it only happens when you're not allowed to look and find out how it happened. Another way to look at this is that macro objects like tennis balls and humans are very intimately connected to the universe. Our every move and path and even thought is recorded in the particles around us and within us. In this way, our whereabouts and even thoughts become part of the fabric of the universe. There's no escaping our intimacy with the forces and particles that we are made up of and surrounded by. And in this way, we are at least informationally, indeed, one with the universe. Guys, I want to tell you about a great on-demand video learning service where you can enjoy lectures from some of the best professors and educators in the world. I just finished several lectures by Professor Benjamin Schumacher on some of the crazy implications of quantum mechanics. One of his lectures, in fact, was an inspiration for this video. If you're intrigued by quantum physics and want to get more in depth, you're going to love Dr. Schumacher and his teaching style. Some of the topics in this course are like quantum computing, quantum cloning, and entanglement. I just love Great Courses Plus, and I'm not just saying that because they're sponsoring me. I would have a subscription to Great Courses Plus regardless. And they're offering an incredible deal right now to Arvind Ash viewers. If you use the link in the description right now, you're going to get a free trial. But be sure to use the special link in the description. And if you like this video, then please share it with your friends and give us a like. Also, if you have a question, please post it below because I try to answer every one of them. And I will see you in the next video, my friend.